Hey guys, I am Venkat and this is part 10 of Blazor WebAssembly video series. In this video, we'll discuss how to implement data grid server-side paging. At the moment, we are on the first page of the data grid and we see the first 5 rows. And in the footer, we also see the total count of rows, 34. And if we take a look at Visual Studio output window, notice 2 queries are issued to the database, cell count of star from employees. Basically, this is retrieving the total number of rows that we have in the employees database table, which is then used by the grid to display the total count here in the footer and also compute the number of pages to display. And the second query retrieves the actual 5 rows that we are displaying. Notice we are selecting all the columns from employees table, and then we have 2 parameters at P0 and at P1. The value for P0, as you can see right here, is 0, and the value for P1 is 5. So basically, these 2 parameters are telling skip the first 0 rows and retrieve 5 rows. Basically, retrieve the first 5 rows because you're still on the first page. Now, let me click on the third page here and see what's going to happen. So on the third page, we're able to see rows from 11 to 15, and the total count is still 34. So if we take a look at Visual Studio again, notice another set of 2 queries are issued. Again, select count of star to retrieve the total number of employees. And then if we take a look at this query, notice it's the same query. The only difference here is the parameter values. Okay, P0 is now 10 and P1 is 5. So basically, it's telling the SQL query to skip the first 10 rows and then retrieve the next 5 rows. Okay, so that's why it's able to return us rows from 11 to 15. So this is server-side paging, only retrieving the rows that we are displaying to the user. This is much better from a performance standpoint because we're not unnecessarily retrieving data that we are not displaying to the user. Especially if you have millions and millions of rows in the database, this is the sort of paging that we want to use. Server-side paging is also commonly called on-demand paging or database paging. We discussed implementing client-side paging in part 8 of this video series. I'll include the link to the complete course page in the description box below this video. Now, here's the important point to keep in mind. To implement server-side paging, the data grid needs to know 2 things: the count of total rows and the list of rows to display. The data grid uses the total count of rows and the page size to calculate the number of pages to display in the pager in the data grid footer. So our first step is to modify our server-side REST API so it's able to return paged data and not all the rows. We want to be able to pass these 2 parameters to our API, skip and take, so the API knows how many rows to skip and how many rows to actually retrieve. At the moment, when we navigate to this URI, /API/employees, we see the list of all employees. And that's not what we want. We want to be able to pass in the URI 2 query string parameters, skip and take. So skip 10 rows and take 20 rows. At the moment, our API is not making use of these 2 parameters. So let's modify it so the API returns paged data. Our employees controller is in this controllers folder in blazorproject.server. If we scroll a bit down, it is this getEmployees method that returns us the list of all employees, and it's calling getEmployees method on our employee repository. Employee repository is present in this models folder. So let's open both employee repository class and the interface iEmployee repository. The first thing that we need to do here is modify getEmployees method. We want to introduce those 2 parameters, skip and take. The data type for both the parameters is integer. Next, let's modify the implementation. Implementation is in this file, employeeRepository.cs, and the name of the method is getEmployees. First, we need to introduce those 2 parameters, skip and take. So both of them are of type integer. I'm also going to specify default values just in case if we don't provide explicitly any values for these 2 parameters. So by default, we want to skip 0 rows and take 5 rows. Notice when I hover the mouse over this employees property from the IntelliSense, you can see it is of type dbset of employee. And on this property, we have skip and take extension methods. So all we do here is pass the incoming parameters, skip to the skip method and take to the take method. Remember, we want to return two things from this method: the total number of employee rows that we have and the five rows that we want to display in the data grid. So for that, we need a new class. So what I'm going to do is, in our shared project, add a new class. Name it employee data result. First, let's make this class public. And we need two properties: employees, which is of type IEnumerable of employee objects. This is going to hold the list of five employees that we want to display in the data grid. Count is going to hold the total count of employees. And then we are going to specify this class as the return type, both in our interface and implementation. So for getEmployees method, instead of returning IEnumerable of employee objects, we are going to return task of employee data result. Let's do the same change in the implementation class as well. In the method body, let's create a new instance of employee data result. Let's call the variable result and populate both these properties, employees and count. To get the count on appdbcontext.employees property, we have count async. Let's await its execution and finally return this employee data result. Next, in employees controller, on this getEmployees method, we need to include the same set of two parameters, skip and take. So let me actually copy them from our employee repository and paste them right here. All that is left to do is pass these two incoming parameters to getEmployees method on our employee repository. With all these changes in place, let's run our project and quickly test. Our page fails to load data. That's because we have an unhandled exception, and we'll fix that in just a bit. At the moment, when we navigate to our API URL, api/employees, notice we're not explicitly specifying any values for skip and take parameters. So it's using the default values, 0 for skip, 5 for take. So we see the first set of 5 rows, and we also have the total count of employees, 34. And if we explicitly provide values for skip and take, 10 for skip, 20 for take. So it's skipping the first 10 rows and retrieving the next 20 rows. So we see rows from 11 to 20. Again, we still have the total count of employees, which is 34. Next, let's take a look at the changes that we have to make in this blazorproject.client. Remember, our Syncfusion data grid is present on this page, index.razor. We're going to do a lot of cleanup on this page. First of all, we don't need the spinner component because the data grid is smart enough to display its own spinner if it's waiting for data. So let's delete the style and the spinner component itself. We also don't need this if check. In the code block, except this pager dropdown property, we can delete everything else. Now, to keep this example focused on paging, let's remove all these properties related to sorting. In our upcoming videos, we'll discuss implementing custom sorting as well. As you can see, paging is already turned on. Oh, we have another property here related to sorting, so let's get rid of this as well. Now, to retrieve and bind server-side page data, we're going to use custom data binding along with Syncfusion data manager component. So inside this grid, let's include Syncfusion data manager component, and the tag for that is SF data manager. To keep the code simple, let's move the namespace syncfusion.blazor.data to imports.razor file. At using syncfusion.blazor.data. Remember, with this grid, we want to use custom data binding. And for that, we need a custom data adapter. So let me add a new class to the services folder in our client project. Name it employee adapter. For this class to behave like custom data adapter, it has to derive from the built-in Syncfusion abstract class data adapter. This class is present in syncfusion.blazor namespace, and we want to override read method because it is this method that provides the data to the grid. And notice there are two variations, read and read async. We can use either of them. Let's override read async. On this incoming data manager request object, notice from the IntelliSense, we have skip and take properties. So we can use these properties to retrieve the page data from our server-side REST API. We'll do that in just a bit. But before that, we need to modify our client-side employee service. So let's open both the employee service class and its interface, iEmployee service. On this getEmployees method, include the two parameters, skip and take. We also need to change the return type to employee data result. We need to make similar changes in the implementation class, employee service. Our getEmployees method is right here. First, we need to pass the two parameters, skip and take, and change the return type to employee data result. Even in this return statement, we need to change the data type to employee data result. And in the REST API URL, we need to include the two query string parameters, skip and take. Query string parameters start with question mark, skip equals the incoming skip parameter, and similarly, take equals the incoming take parameter. Next, in our custom employee data adapter, we need to inject this iEmployee service. So we need a constructor for that. Inject iEmployee service. Let's call the parameter employee service and then generate the required private field. Inside this read async method, let's use the injected employee service. And on that, we have getEmployees method. We need to pass values for both the parameters, skip and take. And we know we have the values for these two parameters on the incoming data manager request object. This is an async method, so let's await its execution. And let's not forget to turn this method into async. And whatever result we get back, let's store that in employee data result object. Let's bring in the required namespace. And let's call the variable result. Now, here's the important point to keep in mind. The SyncFusion data grid component expects this read async method to return an object of type data result. So let's create a new instance of this class. And this class is present in syncfusion.blazor.data namespace. Let's call the variable data result equals new data result. This class has two properties, result, and it should contain the list of employees that we want to display. And we know that list of employees are present in this variable result dot employees. As you can see from the IntelliSense, it returns iEnumerable of employee objects, that is the list of employees that we want to display in the grid. And we should also let the grid know the total count of employees. Again, we have that in the count property of our result object. Finally, return the data result object. Next, we need to register our custom employee adapter with the ASP.NET Core dependency injection system. In a Blazor WebAssembly project, we do that in the main method. And the main method is present in this file, program.cs. So builder.services.addScoped employee adapter. Finally, we need to tell the data grid about this custom employee adapter. Our data grid is in index.blazor page, so let's open that. With this SyncFusion data manager component, we want to use a custom adapter, and we tell that by setting adapter equals adapters.customAdapter. Finally, we need to tell this data manager to use an instance of our custom employee adapter class. We specify that by using adapter instance property, and then we use type of keyword employee adapter. Now, here's another important point to keep in mind. Since we are using a custom adapter to provide the data to the grid, we no longer need this data source property. Instead, we need T value. Basically, this property tells the type of object the grid is working with. In our case, it's working with employee objects. With all these changes in place, let's run our project. There we go. We see the first 5 employees as expected. And if we take a look at the output window in Visual Studio, notice we see both the queries as expected. Select count of star, which retrieves the total count of employees, and this query right here retrieves the first 5 employees. And one interesting thing to note here is the parameter values are not displayed. Instead, a question mark is displayed next to both the parameters P0 and P1. To see the parameter values, we have to enable sensitive data logging. And we do that in startup.cs file. So in this blazorproject.server, we have our startup.cs file. Let's open that. In configure services method, on this line where we are configuring our SQL Server instance, we need to chain enable sensitive data logging method. With this change in place, let's run our project again. As expected, we see the first 5 rows, and if we take a look at Visual Studio, we see the parameter values as well. P0 is 0, P1 is 5. Remember, the first parameter is skip, and the second parameter is take. Since we are on the first page, we want to skip 0 rows and take the first 5 rows. Now let's see what's going to happen when we navigate to page 3. If we take a look at Visual Studio, notice the second query right here. P0 value is 10 and P1 value is 5. So basically, we are skipping the first 10 rows. That's why when we are on the third page, we see the rows from 11 to 15. And these are 5 rows. So the second parameter value, P1, is 5. Notice, when I reload this page, the data grid is smart enough to display its own inbuilt spinner while waiting for server-side data. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.